Hello, welcome to a new episode. Today's topic is the clustering analysis. We'll be talking about the so-called k-means clustering. This is perhaps one of the most widely used clustering methods. The characteristics of the k-means clustering are as following. It is an unsupervised machine learning method. We have to find the hidden structure from unlabeled data. The objective is to partition the observations into k-clusters. Each cluster is defined by a center or mean called centroid. The clustering is carried out by an iterative algorithm. We'll see more about this in the following example. Let's suppose that we have n observations or vectors in two dimensions. This is denoted as x1, x2, up to xn. We have chosen a 2D example because the observations can be plotted on a plane as we can see here. Then let's suppose that our objective is to partition the observations into two clusters. In order to do so, the first step is to randomly place two centroids. The centroids represented by red diamonds can be anywhere initially. Then the idea is to move the centroids in such a way that the sum of the square distances between the observations and the centroids is minimized. The distance metric that we are using here is the so-called Euclidean distance. Now back to the figure. Let us see how in reality this iterative procedure works. We'll continue with the iterative cycles and the centroids converge to their final positions. And the clusters are defined by these centroids, mu1 and mu2. After this example, let's see another one. Now, using the same data set, let's suppose their objective is to partition the observations into three clusters, or k equal to 3. Initially, three centroids are randomly placed. Then, as before, we continue on with the iteration, arriving at the final configuration as we can see here. So far, so good. Now it's about time to see how all this works in reality. Time to go through an example on the Excel spreadsheet. Okay, here I have already opened this Excel workbook file. In this Excel file named example k-means clustering, we have the data for this example. We can see that there are in total 150 observations or rows. And there are four relevant columns. These columns are named x1, x2, x3, and x4. These columns represent the variables or features. We can safely ignore the first column, which only gives the row number. Now a question, where does this table come from? Our example is based on the iris flower data by Ronald Fisher. It dates back to 1936. As we saw, the dataset has four columns or features. The original dataset has another column corresponding to the species label. In the original table, there were three different species with 50 observations or rows in each, in such a way that the first 50 belong to one species, next 50 to another species, and so on. This makes 150 observations or rows in total. In our example, the species column has been removed to mimic the situation of the unsupervised learning. The features or the columns have the following meaning. X1 corresponds to the sepal length. X2 corresponds to the sepal width. X3 corresponds to the petal length. And X4 corresponds to the petal width. So the question we are asking is, how much information can we retrieve about the original classification structure? Now back to the workbook. Here we go to the PrimaXL tab, click on it, and bring up its ribbon menu. Then we click on the button named Clusters to bring up the k-means clustering menu form. This menu form is quite intuitive. Let's fill it out from top to bottom. At the topmost field, we should specify the data range. We can either type in manually or we can click on the small button on the right and bring up the range input form where we can easily select the data range and return. Next, we specify the number of clusters. We target 3 clusters. The seed is necessary in order to randomize the initial positions of the centroids. Iterate gives the number of steps for the iteration algorithm. A number between 10 and 30 would be sufficient. Too big a number here would unnecessarily slow down everything. We will set it at 15. Finally, we should specify where to output the result. We can check on the output to a new sheet box to create a new result sheet. Okay, I think we are ready. Now we just press the run button. Okay, here we got a new sheet with some results. We can notice that a big Excel table has been created. We can see that the original data has been copied into this new table. However, there are some new columns also. We have the distances between the observations and the centroids. Dist 0 means distance to the centroid 0, dist 1 means distance to the centroid 1, and so on. The last column shows the cluster ID. We can notice that each observation belongs to the cluster of the nearest centroid. Okay, now let's move on to this smaller table. This table gives you the centroid coordinates. And this another table gives you a summary. We can see that the cluster sizes are 50, 38, and 62. Now back to this big table. A nice property of this table is that it is possible to sort by each column. For example, we can go to the last column, cluster ID, click on this arrow button, select sort smallest to largest. Now the observations belonging to the same cluster are always grouped together. So we have the clusters 0, 1, and 2. Finally, a summary. The first 50 observations were clustered together. This is absolutely spot on. However, there are some misclassifications in the remaining clusters. Well, let us remember that we are not given any training data. However, we are able to better understand the data and retrieve some of the original classification structure. Thank you so much for watching this video. Until next time, bye.